Tonight, the human trafficking charge against the CEO of Lambert's Academy and three co-defendants have been withdrawn. The Environmental Health Department has beefed up the monitoring and inspection of butchers for proper meat handling procedures. Government is working with international agencies to ensure St. Lucia takes advantage of available grant funding to deal with climate change and help the country build resilience in the face of looming threats of natural disasters. And a group of underprivileged children are made to feel at home at the official residence of the Governor General. Good evening to you. Welcome to the Monday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polion. Our top story. The human trafficking charge against the CEO of Lambert's Academy and three co-defendants have been withdrawn. Last week's decision was preceded by a little over 2 years of court hearings pertaining to several other charges, which were also dismissed. When the matter surfaced here, it attracted global attention due to human trafficking allegations. DBS's Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage.
In February 2015, a number of students, mainly from Nepal, claimed they were lured here with promises of an education in hospitality and other subjects, as well as job placements overseas, which did not materialize after they each paid approximately US$9,000 to secure a place at the learning institution. Lambert's Academy Chief Executive Officer Dr. Iftikhar Shams and his co-defendants were subsequently arrested. Dr. Shams was charged with money laundering in addition to 49 counts of obtaining property by deception. Along with his three co-defendants, he was also charged with human trafficking. Through a mediation process, 49 charges of obtaining property by deception involving students of the Lambert's Academy and their dependents were resolved on January 30, 2017. The money laundering cases were dismissed by Magistrate Moise on the basis the trial did not commence within 180 days as required by the criminal procedure rule. However, the Office of the Director of Public Prosecution has appealed the matter. On July 14, 2017, after spending 29 months at the Bodley Correctional Facility, three of the accused in the Lambert's Academy human trafficking case were granted bail in the sum of $17,500 each. Still maintaining their innocence, the four accused made several appearances before Magistrate Christine Folcher, who they accused of being biased. According to reliable sources, the December 7th matter was not set for trial, but for the magistrate to address an application made by Dr. Shams to recuse herself from the case, which was instead dismissed. The office of the DPP plans to appeal the matter as it believes the matter can only be dismissed by a judge and not a magistrate. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Meanwhile, several of the Lambert's Academy students are claiming that they have not been compensated. Here once again is Sheffield Gillard.
A number of affected students managed to return home while others languished on island. President of the Indian Heritage Association, Mr. Keith Compton, who visited India recently, met with a number of Nepalese students who indicated to him they are yet to be reimbursed by the St. Lucia government.
You have to remember, some of the students who got this loan had to put something great out to be able to get this loan, because $7,000-$8,000 to these people is an amazing amount of money. And some of them are in trouble because the money is not paid back. Not only is the money not paid back, the interest on the money hasn't been paid back. And you know, sharks, loan sharks, they don't say, well, all right, give us 2%. It's almost, you know, like 100%. So it's really, really bad.
Earlier this year, Acting Director of Public Prosecutions, Dazrian Green, indicated that over $1.3 million was spent to maintain a number of students who were left stranded here for about 2 years in the Lambert's Academy affair. While all the students have returned to their homeland, according to Mr. Compton, they are very distressed and disappointed.
Those students are very upset at our government for not expediting this money, which is theirs. The whole thing was done under a shady atmosphere, I'm sure you realize that. But the fact is, It went to court. And in our solution courts, we found that the guilty party and the monies were supposedly taken, given to the DBP for disbursement. So this should have been done.
The question of students not receiving payments owed to them was posed to Prime Minister Alan Chastney. Attempts to reach the Attorney General were unsuccessful. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, the island's infrastructure minister has defended government's decision to directly award a significant number of contracts involving several state-funded projects. And he says those responsible for leaking the documents will be taken to task. Don Nicholas has more.
Infrastructure Minister Stevenson King says the direct issuance of contracts is covered under the Finance Act, which allows the relevant authorities latitude to make such decisions based on a contractor's experience and track record. The contracts were signed by Economic Development Minister Guy Joseph, who was acting Prime Minister at the time. What Minister King says is illegal is the leaking of documents. He says once identified, the officer or officers responsible for the leakage will be made to face the full brunt of the law.
Whoever has leaked the documents has violated the staff orders. And in a number of cases under Chapter 1, Chapter 4, and Chapter 5 of the staff orders, it is illegal for any public officer to leak any document whatsoever, and as a consequence, can face disciplinary action.
Mr. King added that his ministry is pursuing a very rigorous road rehabilitation program, hence the reason for the direct awarding of contracts, all in an effort to expedite the process. This is also in an effort to meet specific targets within the allotted period of time. As far as he is concerned, the leakage of the documents is nothing short of political mischief.
What is in there? In a number of instances, we are undertaking projects that should have been done 10 years ago. Okay? Projects coming out of the Thomas. We have decided, let us not wait for the World Bank, because the World Bank, some of those projects were intended for consideration by the World Bank. We have made a determination, a very deliberate determination. Let us not sit and wait for the World Bank to come and to procure the services and to get those projects done. We have taken the decision to do it on our own.
Minister King says there were many other contracts that went through the tendering process at the same time. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The 16-year-old United and Strong Advocacy Group, which is seeking to provide an enabling environment for the advancement of human rights for the LGBT local community, says its focus does not include same-sex marriage. Sheffield Gillard picks up the story.
With same-sex marriage legalized in a number of societies, United and Strong notes that to legalize same-sex marriage in St. Lucia, it would require a number of changes to the island's laws. Mr. Charles says recent developments involving Minister for External Affairs Sarah Flood Bobre, who is also founder of Carrie Farm, points to the misguided understanding of what a family consists of. This is a matter, he says, that must be dealt with first before tackling same-sex marriage. Mr. Charles observes that more work can be done to get all sides to dialogue on the matter. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
With a customary high volume of meat consumed during the festive season, the Environmental Health Department has beefed up the monitoring and inspection of butchers for proper meat handling procedures. The department also advises the public to look out for the inspected and passed stamp before purchasing meat. We hear more from Glenn Simon.
The festive season provides the perfect opportunity for new, seasonal and regular butchers to cash in on the high demand for local meats. It is also a time when the Ministries of Health and Agriculture increase their monitoring and surveillance of butchery practices to ensure conformance to public health guidelines and procedures. Senior Environmental Health Officer Ernie Pierre calls on butchers to register early with the Department of Environmental Health to ensure they meet the requirements before slaughtering animals.
The process can entail getting some documents. One, you need to have health certificate for them, for the butchers and the helpers. That is a requirement by law to be able to handle and to vend meat to the public. They need to have health certificates. So we are asking them to come in and to register with our office and to do that very early. There are a number of processes they need to observe. One, they need to go to the police to get what is a butcher's license or permission to slaughter. Once they have this document, the animal for slaughter will also have to receive an anti-mortem inspection. That anti-mortem inspection will be done by the veterinary officers. That must be done at least 24 hours in advance of slaughter.
Securing public health is central to the anti-mortem inspection, which can pick up disease conditions in animals that may not be seen in a post-mortem inspection. An anti-mortem inspection declares the animal fit or unfit for slaughtering. Senior Agricultural Officer in the Veterinary and Livestock Division, Columbus Felipe, explains.
This is a very important process in the slaughtering of animals, especially during the Christmas and festive season. Today, we are doing the anti-mortem inspection where we physically examine the animals to see that they are healthy and fit for slaughtering. Upon passing the inspection, we tag the animal with a specific ID number to say that the animal is fit for slaughtering. If the animal is not fit for slaughtering, we won't tag the animal, but we'll issue a health certificate to say that the animal is fit or not fit for slaughtering.
Prior to slaughtering, butchers must ensure they have the necessary documentation on hand, including a health certificate for the animal, receipt of purchase or declaration of ownership from the police, in readiness for the post-mortem examination.
Upon post-mortem inspection of that animal, once it's fit for slaughter, you would in fact receive another certificate, which is a wholesomeness certificate, which should be kept. The meat will also be stamped with a stamp that reads inspected and passed.
Pierre also referenced the penalties for non-conformance to the procedures.
And if they are not observed, farmers, butchers, they may risk the animal being seized and condemned, because in the absence of the certificate, it therefore means we cannot ascertain that this animal was in fact a healthy animal to have proceeded for slaughter, and as a result, that animal or that the carcass of that animal will be condemned and seized and disposed of.
The public is also advised to be vigilant when purchasing local meats from butchers.
We encourage consumers to look for that stamp on the meat. This stamp will prove that this animal, this carcass, has received inspection by either the Ministry of Health or the Ministry of Agriculture. So, and it is safe to consume.
The Environmental Health Department encourages the public to contact their Bois d'Orange, Vieux-Fort or Soufre offices for information on proper meat handling procedures. From the Ministry of Health and Wellness, Glenn Simon reporting.
The DBS News World continues with the ARC report.
ARC participants got to experience for the first time Extempo by local Calypsonian invader and well-known MC Izai Hall. The visitors also took part in a raffle. They also used Saturday evening's social activity to dance to the drumming of the group Desagweab under the moonlight of the St. Lucia Yacht Club.
We want to get them a taste of the local culture. Hence, we had Invader, Izai Hall, and we had Happy with his drummers. I think they call it Desagweab. Great drumming they did. And the people showed that they enjoyed it so much. You know, you should see them celebrating and jumping. They couldn't help moving with the activity of the drums. But it came off well, and we're just sorry that it had to end so quickly because they had to get back to the marina. But certainly, it's an annual event that the Yacht Club will now be doing, and we are very happy to be part of the whole ARC celebrations when they reach here to help them understand and get to know a little more about St. Lucia and St. Lucia culture.
But it was on Sunday evening at the welcome party for some of the participants at the IGY Marina at Rodney Bay that hundreds of sailors came out to enjoy the food and most anticipated drink, while many boats were still slowly crossing the finish line.
We're here in Rodney Bay Marina welcoming the ARC yachts that have successfully crossed the Atlantic and arrived into St. Lucia. 99 boats so far. That means there's still more than 80 boats still at sea, so still a long way to go. But this weekend's been a really, really busy weekend. We went in on Friday night with just over 30 boats, and so we've had a large number of boats arriving, and then Monday and Tuesday are also going to be busy days with arrivals, and we're certainly hoping that all of the boats will be here in time for the prize giving, which is on Saturday.
The slow pace of the boats coming in did cause a disruption in the scheduling of activities.
Well, what's happening here tonight is the ARC welcome. Now, typically that will happen when we have the ARC Plus prize giving ceremony at Pigeon Point. So we'll have the ARC Plus prize giving first, and then the ARC Plus participants would leave, and the ARC participants would come in for the welcome reception. But what has happened this year is that the winds have been a bit low, so the boats have not come in as quickly as anticipated. I think we have a total of 186 boats taking part in ARC this year, and so far only 99 boats have made it across the finish line. That's about 50%. So given that at the ARC Plus welcome at Pigeon Point, we only had about 7 boats in then, we felt that when a sufficient number of ARC boats came in, it was necessary to put on an occasion for them to show that we appreciate them coming to St. Lucia. So this is what we had to plan then on very short notice.
General Manager of the IGY Rodney Bay Marina, Sean DeVoe, says accommodating 260 boats at the marina has always been a welcomed challenge.
The feeling from the visitors this year, you know, the event so far has gone seamless. From the ARC Plus, as you know, into the ARC, it really has gone seamless. And even the organizers, we've all come together and compared notes and have been very proud of what we have achieved at St. Lucia, you know, through yourselves, the sponsors, through St. Lucia Events Committee, and the World Cruising Club and ourselves. So I think we owe ourselves a big round of applause in pulling off yet so far another successful ARC with the prize giving next week Saturday. We have, as I said earlier on, probably about another 73 boats to welcome here. So I see all of them hopefully being in here for the prize giving and enjoying St. Lucia, and hopefully some of them will make St. Lucia their home.
And so, at least one ARC participant has the sentiments of making St. Lucia his home in the future.
Well, I've been here many times. I mean, I'll come back sometimes with my wife and we'll see a load more of the island. At the moment this year we've just done a bit of charter on the boat, so right now it's just more about the ARC village for us really, and I've got to get the boat prepared so I can fly home. But you know, I'll be coming back at other times, and we'll be taking tours around the island and seeing all that St. Lucia has to offer.
So far the ARC participants have turned up in large numbers at every event prepared for them. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Busquet, and you're watching Street Vibes. National Day activities. Apart from the Festival of Lights and the Lantern Competition, what more do you think would be added to accommodate the national holiday?
The National Day holiday. Well, before we used to have a lot of different activities on that day. Like, if you could remember, we used to have the greasy pool, we used to have different little activities. So I think we should try to bring it back, the culture, so the young people could see what we have, what our culture is. So it wouldn't get lost along the way, you know. So maybe the elder people, those that know how it used to be before, could try to give some ideas, bring the culture back, and have the people come back together, like, you know, St. Lucians, be proud St. Lucians to enjoy the culture of National Day.
Put more police out to secure people. That's what I could say. Put more people out to secure the people.
More people?
Yes, that's it.
Or more police?
Yeah, put more police out to secure the people.
Well, to make National Day more real, National Day was more real a few years back because they had cycle race, they had a greasy pole, they had the pig again in the
pig.
Greasy pig and all them kind of things. You understand what I'm saying? But right now, National Day, without that, it fade away. We don't consider National Day as National Day like before because it was more active before, you know, and it was more, you know, people is more come out, especially up by VG side there. It was more thing before. But right now, it doesn't make any sense. To me, National Day is dying out. With that, right, the greasy pole and the greasy pig and the cycle race, you know, it will be more active. People rolling, you know, and these kind of things, right? More people will be coming out. But right now, it doesn't make no sense because when they had it up there, I was always there. I even used to want to try and catch the pig too. You understand? But right now, it doesn't make no sense.
As for the patriotism, I don't think we're such a very patriotic society. We love parties. We love enjoying ourselves. Like you said earlier, they had other activities in previous years. The only thing that I could suggest is if the government sponsors stage and lights and a free concert with all Lucian bands and artists, maybe something like that, while at the event, probably a bunch of local dishes and something like that. It'll take a little more thinking for me to really come up with something good that would attract a lot of the youth, let them know what National Day is about, etc.
You've just been watching Street Vibes of me, Alex Bousquet, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You are watching St. Lucia's Television and News Leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, a government minister is promising more boots on the ground to fight crime. And wait not for the helpline. Welcome back to the DBS News World. A government minister is promising a heavy police presence at upcoming festivals to mark the start of the festive season. Her assurance comes amidst a recent spike in criminal activity. Don Nicholas reports.
support the event and be a part.
Culture Minister Fortuna Bellrose says the Royal St. Lucia Police Force is working in tandem with the Castries Constituency's Council to ensure that there is heavy police presence at the Festival of Lights and National Day events. The minister's statement comes in light of the record number of homicides for the year, which stands at 54.
I think the police have been all mobilized, and of course there's been constant dialogue with the police department and the organizers of the event to ensure that we deliver a safe event to the people of St. Lucia. But the police are integrally involved in what is happening with the planning for Festival of Lights.
Minister Bellrose also provided a summary of the activities scheduled to take place.
During the event, of course, we'll also see the Parade of the Lanterns, and as you know, the lantern building has been happening across the country. Jacmel, Miku, as well as Castries have been working to produce these lanterns. And of course, we'll get a chance to see these lanterns on show. And of course, they'll also be awarded. The prizing will also happen. The prize giving ceremony will also happen for these lanterns as well on that day. We encourage St. Lucians to come out and support the event and be a part of it. And of course, we look forward to a great evening.
Festival of Lights and National Day celebrations will be held on December 12th and 13th, respectively. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
We continue the broadcast with news that a consultant psychiatrist at the Mental Wellness Center is calling on persons who are contemplating suicide to utilize the helpline, which is manned by trained counselors. He says that the service is being put to good use, as without it, the suicide situation could have been even graver.
Suicide, the act of intentionally causing one's own death, has many risk factors, including substance abuse, alcoholism, schizophrenia, mental disorders such as depression, among others. The St. Lucia National Mental Wellness Center is the lead institution on island caring for persons exhibiting suicidal tendencies. Consultant psychiatrist Dr. Julius Gillard believes that the public is not sufficiently aware of the help available or what they should do when persons express or exhibit suicidal behavior.
I know persons may feel that the rate of suicide is probably beginning to get out of hand. But what must be understood is that a lot of persons do not know about the helpline. So if you are with somebody and you cannot ensure their safety, you need to at least pass them on to somebody who can do so. So if it's a family member, let the family member know what the person has expressed and that they should stay with that person, keep an eye on that person until they see a professional. You can as well call 203. So call 203 and get their assistance, because they have procedures in place to handle situations like that. Somebody who expresses suicide. So the objective is to keep the person safe until they get to see a professional who can advise them as to the best way forward from there to make suicide a less attractive option for them.
The 203 helpline has come under fire from some members of the public who question the effectiveness of having a helpline. Dr. Gillard indicated that the helpline has been very effective.
Without the helpline, the suicide rate would probably be maybe in the hundreds. So, yes, we still have suicide, and yes, our objective is zero. But we are there, the help is there. And what persons need to do instead of bashing it is to let persons know about its existence. Because what I'm seeing is that there are a lot of persons who do not know about its existence, and they, when they go through that period of hopelessness, they have nowhere to turn to. So if they know about the helpline, they know they have somewhere to turn to that they can get help.
The consultant psychiatrist added that there is still much stigma attached to psychiatry in St. Lucia, which may have been the result of what occurred in the past, where persons with mental illness were treated very inhumanely, as if they were the illness. Dr. Gillard aims to reduce this stigma.
We're in 2017, and there's a great shift in the field of psychiatry where persons now need what the focus of treatment now is not alleviation of symptoms, but rather improvement of functioning in persons with mental illnesses. So the stigma now must be tackled, because that's the main issue impeding the improvement of psychiatric services anywhere around the world.
Dr. Gillard recently carried this message of hope to a mental wellness symposium at the Bellevue Combined School, where he spoke on the topic of mental wellness, suicide, and depression. From the Ministry of Health and Wellness, Glenn Simon reporting.
And now this. The Department of Fisheries has issued an advisory to members of the public regarding the lobster fishery. Alex Buske has the details.
Yvonne Edwin, Information and Communications Officer at the Department of Fisheries, says though we are still in the open season, persons should be aware of how they purchase lobsters.
We need to remind persons that they should not buy lobsters that have been spared. They should not have lobsters in their possession that are undersized, and undersized meaning 9.5 centimeters. Anyone who has a lobster that is molting, carrying eggs, is undersized or of sublegal size, they are subject to a fine of $5,000.
The Department of Fisheries official says the department has various reasons for the early notice and warning.
You have ACK, which is upcoming, and you know a number of persons will be looking forward to enjoying our seafoods. Lobster season being open, we want to remind persons of the regulations and the conditions in place. And also during the festive season, you have a lot of persons going out to restaurants and hotels to have dinner. And again, these regulations would fall into that period.
Ms. Edwin says the department wants to ensure that consumers and purchasers alike are aware of the regulations. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
When we come back in just a moment, St. Lucia is aiming for grant funding to weather the storm. Welcome back to the DBS News World. The government of St. Lucia is working along with international agencies to ensure the island takes advantage of available grant funding to deal with climate change and help the country build resilience in the face of looming threats of natural disasters. According to St. Lucia's Sustainable Development Minister, government has seen it fit to work with various international agencies which will provide the personnel required to tap into these resources. Don Nicholas reports.
Too often, according to Sustainable Development Minister Dr. Gail Rigobert, avenues to access available grant funding are disclosed during high-level meetings, but human resource constraints within the relevant ministries make it impossible for St. Lucia to take advantage of such opportunities. It is for this reason that the government has seen it fit to work with various international agencies who will provide the personnel required to tap into these funds. This provision will come at no cost to the government.
I was able to engage at least two or three agencies who have committed to making available to St. Lucia additional personnel so that we can very purposefully pursue the available money for treating with the issues of climate change, and that is a very welcome opportunity.
The minister went on to address the matter of funding for designated emergency shelters. At the moment, too many schools are being used for that purpose at the expense of covering the school syllabus.
How many of the schools that are currently dubbed emergency shelters, how many of them have water harvesting systems or have alternative power supplies? And in that regard, therefore, we are considering alternative forms of technology so as to ensure that there would not be an interruption in the supply of water and electricity, for example.
These were some of the matters discussed at the 23rd Conference of Parties in Germany. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The nation's head of state over the weekend assisted in spreading Christmas cheer to a group of underprivileged children. We hear more in this report.
The event, hosted by the National Community Foundation with assistance from the Ministry of Social Transformation, brought much-needed Christmas joy to underprivileged children from the island's southern communities.
We recognize that trying to raise funds and do that in St. Lucia is getting a little bit, you know, tight, and so we decided to try to reach out to the diaspora. So I visited New York and met with the diaspora. The consulate office launched a toy drive, and all the toys that were collected were shipped to the National Community Foundation for distribution. So we figured rather than just go in and distribute, we wanted to do something really nice for the children.
The children, who were selected by the Ministry of Social Transformation, were gifted with a variety of treats and entertainment.
We have Santa Claus, who's going to be visiting a little later to present the toys to the children. We have bouncy castles, we have masquerade, we have storytelling, we have a few performances, and the DJ, we're going to do musical chairs, there's going to be an elf hunt, so there are a lot of things in store for the children.
The gracious host, Dame Paulette Louise, expressed her appreciation for the NCF's work and the joy of the day's activities.
Looks like it's a success so far, and it looks like they're enjoying themselves. I'm happy that it is a good day today. I was a bit concerned yesterday when the rain came, but as I say, I've been patron of the foundation since its inception, and I take part in other activities and support them in many other ways.
For the DBS News World, I am Trisha Cadet.
In entertainment news, Jamaican reggae artist Idonia, who has performed here on several occasions, landed at the George F.L. Charles Airport this morning. He has promised to thoroughly entertain his fans.
Same energy, is it maybe higher energy, you know, because we always aim to please, we always give, you know, a full 150%. So high energy, you know, come for entertain, whole heap of jumping, ladies can enjoy themselves, the man them can enjoy themselves. We just come for pleasing, you know, pace yourself through, because, you know, over the years, you know, we have a couple, over a couple songs, so we have a nice catalogue. Just put together the show and just stay on the stage and deliver, is it me, high energy, and everybody got to enjoy themselves. Money's worth, aim to please, straight.
The artist says he usually visits St. Lucia for varying reasons.
Well, just the love of the people, you know, you see me? It's like one of my next home away from home, you see me? Every time I come here, it's just always, you see me? A warm welcome, you see me? Fans love the thing, people love the thing, so we love St. Lucia. So once we get the call for come to St. Lucia, we're going to come, because it's always a great time here, you see me? Straight, love the island.
Idonia will perform at Pigeon Island tomorrow evening. Court St. Lucia hosted a major local furniture exhibition on Saturday. We hear more in this report.
The exhibition, dubbed Made in St. Lucia with Pride, featured beautifully crafted pieces from local manufacturers as part of the company's National Day observance.
We always try to come up with interactive ways to encourage persons to come in and see the variety of products that we offer. And a lot of people still don't know that some of the furniture that they see on the shop floor every day are made in St. Lucia. So National Day is just around the corner, it's on Wednesday, and we figure, okay, what can we do to tie in, you know, some of our products with what's happening right now. So National Day, National Pride, Made in St. Lucia with Pride.
The event, which was held at Courts Marisol, also showcased other local small businesses, giving them the opportunity to sell their products and build on their client base.
There are a lot of hidden treasures in St. Lucia that you don't know about unless you come to things like these. I think it's really a wonderful thing that Courts is doing, and I think that they should implement this Handmade in St. Lucia with Pride thing every single year, because today I came and I saw a lot of beautiful furniture that I didn't even know was produced right here, and it really makes me proud to be a St. Lucian.
According to Courts officials, the company is dedicated to providing St. Lucians with excellent shopping experiences as well as supporting local manufacturers. For the DBS News World, I am Trisha Cadet.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues with Kenson Casimir. Finally from us, on the lighter side. The Thomas Fire in Southern California has burned through at least 90,000 acres, but it has not done anything to sway human decency. As the fires raged along Highway 1 in Ventura County, a rabbit darted across the lanes of traffic and into the burning brush. A man who saw it happen decided he had to help. With smoke and flames all around, the man attempts to find the rabbit, but the search is a difficult one. The man jumps up and down and grabs his head in frustration that he can't find the rabbit. Finally, shouting with outstretched hands and wading into the brush, the man seems to convince the rabbit to move, but perhaps a bit too quickly. The man perseveres, however, and is able to scoop up the rabbit. The man clutches the bunny close to him as the video ends. This wasn't the first animal rescue during these wildfires, and probably won't be the last. Last week, humans rallied to save a horse that fell into a crevice while attempting to escape the fires. Thanks to the efforts the horse is expected to make a full recovery. Time now for the usual reminder. The human trafficking charge against the CEO of Lambers Academy and three co-defendants have been withdrawn. The Environmental Health Department has beefed up the monitoring and inspection of butchers for proper meat handling procedures. Government is working with international agencies to ensure St. Lucia takes advantage of available grant funding to deal with climate change and help the country build resilience in the face of looming threats of natural disasters. And a group of underprivileged children are made to feel at home at the official residence of the Governor General. And that's a broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polnia, wishing you a very good evening. See you next time.